Now, let's go through this matrix. I want to run through all of these metrics to analyze it. Now, let's assume that we had BTC there and let's analyze the BTC now. So now, for introduction, I want to know the name of the coin. That's straightforward. The token or coin of the project. The name of the project, the token or coin of the project. Now, when was the coin founded? The sector, token type, all of this, I don't think they need much explanation. Consensus algorithm, I'm sure by now you should know, proof of stake, proof of work. There are different types of proof of stakes. And after proof of work, that's like the most popular one right now. So after all of that, you move down to the project specifics. So all of this, you fill this gap. So you fill this gap with the research that you'll be doing on this coin. And now what I've done for you is I've added a pop-up of resources that you can do research based on the categories, based on the sectors. So let's say you come to project specifics. Now you want to know the project specifics of Bitcoin. You click on the project specific tab, the heading, and you see Mazari, you see Binance Research, you see YouTube, you see Project Medium blog. Then you know that these are four good resources that you can look on to know more about this project. So with this now, all you need to find out is what is this project and how does it work. Secondly, the coin, the BTC is auto-filled because of this space here, because I filled it here. So if I change this now to Bitcoin, what we read here now is what is Bitcoin and how does it work. If I change this to Sol, what reads here now is what is Sol and how does it work. So the Sol, the first part is talking about the project. The second part is talking about the token or coin of the project. So don't get that confused. So now on to the next use case. So let's go back. So after analyzing what this coin is, what you do now is you score the project based on what you think of this project. Is it a good project? Do you think that this is necessary? Because I've seen some funny cryptocurrency projects that project about for dentists who want to fix their like project to contribute for dentists to work on teeth, project for pennies or project from useless project. So with that now, you grade the project on what you think about it. Is it worth it? Can this be achieved without blockchain technology? Is there a point of bringing this into blockchain? Does this solve any problem? That's where the use case comes. So after doing the research, you take a note here. Any remark you feel like leaving, you leave it here, so that in the future it might be you or for someone else who wants to see your how you feel about the project, can basically simply read your remarks. This space here is for the facts of the project. You've like the brief of the facts, and this is for what you think about the project. So the remarks. Then now you grade the project. All of these scoreboard are graded from the range of 0 to 10. So if you put anything outside of that range, you get an error. Simple as that. So you must put something within the range. And I've also color programmed this such that if the color code you get is determined by your number use. Let's say I use 0 now, I get a very deep red. I tell you that the rating is very low. That doesn't necessarily mean bad, it just means that that's the score you've given it. So if you put one a little bit brighter than a little bit orange, then now if you put 10, you get a very green. And everything here is rated over 10 by 10. Why everything is rated by 10? If I've gone straight to use the value allocation I used here to just put it straight, like what you have here in gray, like 2.5, I want you to grade this over 2.5. You know that would be really confusing, right? Because I give you same thing to grade over 3. And also give you the same thing to grade over 7. And when you compare the grade you give, you might get different results. So to make it even, everything is over 10. And also another advantage of this is anytime you want to change the weight of this, the value of this, you don't need to change your score again. So whatever you put here, whatever value you put here, it will automatically convert the grade you've given it into that. So, I know you love it.
Now
let's go. Use case. For the use case now, I want to know what problem is this project solving. Is it Chainlink as an oracle driving the reward data for the blockchain? Is it Bitcoin store of value? Is it Ethereum? Ethereum, no, it's like the internet of blockchain, so there's so much I can say about it. Also, the project goal. I want to know about the project goal. Can this goal be achieved? And what new innovation is this bringing to the blockchain? Because these are two different, don't mistake these two metrics here. Because what changes is this bringing to the blockchain is different from what new innovation. Because there are several projects that are doing this, that are tackling the same problem. But if you look deep into them, some of them have different approaches. And some of them are also bringing something new. Just like we have a lot of Ethereum killers that are basically trying to do what Ethereum is doing, but better. So now, what are they doing? What is the new thing they are bringing now to the chain? That's what I want to know. So all of that now, I will grade all of this over 10, and I will grade this new, what the new thing they are bringing over 10. And I don't need to talk much about this. Converts this to the real value. So this is the total marks for this is 10. So this is 5, this is 5. So when you grade this over 10, it converts what you get to. Let's say you grade over 7. It converts this, the scale of 1 to 10 converted to a scale of 0 to 5. 0 to 10. Was the 7 on the scale of 0 to 10 converted to X in the scale of 0 to 5. So that's what you get. So now, let's move on. Now, management and team. This is also another, team management, developer, investors, and partner. This is also another, an important metric, because you want to be sure that the people handling this project are capable of delivering. And also, you want to be sure that this project is worth something to the big boys, but I already have the money, because you know retail money really doesn't push the market. That's the truth. So you want to be sure that this project has also caught the eyes of investors. And as you can see, there are a lot of there are useful sites. There are also sites that you can check this. You can use Messari for this. You can use Binance Research. You can use ICO Drop. You can use Crunchbase. You can use LinkedIn. You can use YouTube. So to get the details for all of these informations, I've given you resources. So all you need is this template. You really don't need anything else. Because I've given you the resources where you can find what you're looking for. I've given you a matrix of creating it. And I've given you what you do with the results you get. So let's move further. So now, technology. Yes, you can have a good idea, a good concept and everything. But now, come to how you execute it. The technology. Is this good? I know you might be saying, but not, I'm not so technical. How can I know the project is worth it? How can I rate the project based on technology when I don't know so much? Well, these are very easy to check. You don't even really need to know coding or anything. If you don't know coding, all you need to do is to go to a place like GitHub. Like for instance, I'm giving you resources. You can see GitHub here. Let me just zoom in a little bit. I feel like some people might be struggling to see this. So, I've given you sources like GitHub. You can go to GitHub and you can see the interactions on this project. You can, and there are also tools that you can use, like CryptoMiso. Then, when you go down, you see a little more tools that research. And you can also use a white paper, because another good resource to use, you can use YouTube. YouTube really helps you understand the concept, the technology of a project, because especially interviews with the founders, because they try to break down this project to a layman's level, so anybody can understand. So from those interviews, you can tell, oh, you are like this. This is a tech that I see myself using, and always invest in what you believe in. So if a project that you can relate with, I don't see why you should. You maybe for the money, because being right and making money are two different things. So maybe for the money, but if once you have a peace of mind, also invest in things you also believe in. So when you go on these interviews and you hear the founders talking on the project, and you see that okay, this has potentials. What you do is they come here and compare them. And the metrics that I've used here are not very technical. Like, for instance, say, what are the critical components of the project? This is something you can get from an interview or a white paper, easy. Or if you don't want to go deep as a white paper, even from their blog post, you can get this. Or even a random research covering the project can give you this. You get. Now, how is the security like? You can compare it to something else. You know that there's a cryptocurrency trilemma. You look for a project that is similar to it. I know if has this project ever faced is a difficult challenge and how did they overcome it? For instance, now Solana was bragging about achieving the Bitcoin trilemma until recently, not so recent, but they had a crash, and we all got to find out that it's not as decentralized as it claims. You get. So now you move on. Can it be scaled? Can crypto be scaled? Up until Lightning Network, Bitcoin was facing this challenge. So now the next one, decentralized. How decentralized? I just mentioned Solana. How decentralized is the crypto? I just mentioned Solana, so you know what I'm talking about. So now, how decentralized can the protocol get? This is different from how decentralized is it. Because a new project, I don't expect a new project that I'm analyzing to be so decentralized right now because it's still new in the space. But I want to know how decentralized can it get. When Solana came out, I knew this is a coin potential with the speed and security. Let's say with the speed, sure. How decentralized can it get? Probably, maybe it, at that time it had a lot. I forgot how many validators it had. But if you add two and two together, you know that this can get really decentralized because it requires a lot of resources to keep these nodes running. And this kind of resources can only be provided by institutions. So you really can't get this decentralization you are looking for in a project like that. So you can score average here and score really bad here. I don't say I can score high and score bad here. So you can score average here and score really bad here because you know you can't get really decentralized. So now let's move on to tokenomics. Everyone's favorite. So with tokenomics now, what I want to know is I want to know the market cap, because the market cap tells me how much room there's left for upward movement, and also the circulating supply, how much is left for circulating supply, and the total supply ratio, how much is out, how much of this crypto is in supply compared to how much is still reserved. Then next, now liquidity ratio. Liquidity ratio basically the daily volume and the daily volume over market cap times 100. So with this, when I am teaching how to build this template, I will explain this further. I know what value you should be looking for, what range of values you should be looking for. So now, potential growth based on market cap and dilution. From this, you already know if a coin like, let's say Audio, for instance. Audio right now is worth about, give or take, 800 million USD. And Audio is trying to compete with big music platform like Spotify, Apple Music. Now, I want to know what is the net worth of Apple. How I get this now? Compare what is the net worth of Apple Music, Spotify, like the competitors of Audio. Now, I won't evaluate audio to get the same market cap as that, but at least I'll use that as a metric to know how much room is left for audio to go. So the growth potential. So I know audio right now, I know there's still a lot of growth potentials with audio. But now the next metrics now is the reason why I won't go into audio right now. Token allocation. Pre-mine allocation distribution. Audio's token allocation at this moment is it's not something to talk about. The most of the token is held in the hands of a few people and is a valuable token. I'm so valuable for audio to dump because of this allocation. I want to see the initial investors dump the coin and I'm gonna pick some. But this is not Michelle Nodio, please. This is not Michelle Nodio. I'm sorry if it sounds like that. So now, vesting and inflation. I want to know how much of these coins will be released over a period of time so that I can easily time when to enter the market. Because you could pick a good coin and in a month's time, the price dump because you didn't check to see the next time the rate at which new coins is released into circulation from the project. So for inflation, for Vesna, for the inflation of the token, I'm hoping to end it something below 3% for excellent. Oh, this is below 2% for very good. Then excellent, I'll probably be looking at deflationary coins, like what Ethereum is turning to be right now. And then ADA is going to be deflationary at some point. So for excellent, probably looking for deflationary coins because, you know, when you reduce supply and whether demand stays the same or not, price goes up. Now, staking and utility, like other, these also demand drivers. I don't know how good these demand drivers are because all of this token is basically the economics of the token. So everything that has to do with supply and demand of this token, that's all I'm talking about here. So is there staking for this token? Staking is a good demand factor because now you have, especially those coins that have a long period or even a week of lockup period, so that when the price action happens, you don't just get random coins from nowhere coming to dump any price action that's happening. So if I see that a coin has a lockup period of a week and above, and most of the coins are staked, oh my god, that's a very good buy. So I will rate that very high. You get. So now address activities. I want to see that this coin is in use. I want to see that this coin is being used. It's not just being held by people waiting for a pump, then they dump. And I have provided you resources for you to check that. You have blockchain express for that. You have Etherscan. You have ICO drop, and also the white price. Also a good resource to check some of these things. And also the Dune analytics I mentioned in our last video. Yeah, that too. We'll also be using that for on-chain analysis. Now, risk assessment. As every investor, you must always consider the risks of your investments. You get cryptocurrency. Everyone is coming into crypto space. It's buzzing right now. What also means that the big boys, the big banks are also looking at us. Oh, this is free money. You get. This is free money to pick up. So you have to check every coin you invest in. What are the possible risks of this? Could it be geographica? Could it be token concerns like the allocations? Could it be a security in disguise? Because then you know your position is under threat. Now, could it be a rug pull or a scam? Because a lot of coins that are only exposed to the DeFi environment, like DEX, a lot of them are rug pulls because anyone can just list their coin. You get. But also, you want to know the competitors. Because a coin can be good and all, but when you look in the space and I say, oh, there's so many competitors for this, before this can make its way through the crowd, oh my god, we would have stampeded on it to death. So you want to know about the competitors. And if there's any other mix you feel are missing out, sure, consider that. Then when you're done, you rate it. Now, future projection, the roadmap of this coin. Some projects, they are very sketchy. Any project that wrote my first of all, I don't see why I want to invest in a project like that. Except the other ways for you to, like the other metrics are really strong. So when the project does have metrics, I don't think I won't go through the rest of this. Because there's no point, because the rest is roadmap integrity. What are you checking integrity for when you don't have something to check them? Understand? So now, when you, the integrity of roadmap, now I've tried to break, I've broken it down here. Do they have a good track record of hitting their target? Check that. How often do they meet their deadline? Check that. Do the targets seem attainable? You take that. Questionable diversion in project history from initial plan? You check that. So all of this makes up the integrity of this project. So that's what I want to check. Then you grade it. Understand? This is also another form of risk assessment. Project future projection is also another form of risk assessment. And it's something I need you to take serious, because this is how you catch a project, a shit coin. That's what my friends would like to say, a shit coin. So next, comparison and value extrapolation. Oh, my favorite part. So now we've analyzed all of the above metrics and I knew that, okay, this is a good coin. But I want to know what is the full potential of this coin? Because the full potential, the function of full potential and the coin market cap is equal to how much upside I have to make. So now I want to know the closest competitors. Something that audience don't really have any competition. The only one I know of is Bitify, and it's living on a layer 2 of Ethereum on Matic. And so, something like OG, I'm always using OG for, because it's a coin that I relate with. I love music a lot, so it's something I relate with. So something like OG now, the competition will be very low. So you could score high here. I'm not grading this actually. I just want to write it so that it's something you know. And so I don't see the reason, I don't see the need to grade this when you've already considered a lot of the other metrics. But if you feel you need to grade it, you can customize it to do it. So now, value extrapolation now. So top project in the same category. Now let's say you have smart contract. Let's say Ego. Hey, I don't know if you know this. Oh, let me just use something common. Let's say Polkadot. You have Polkadot, a smart contract project, and you want to compare it, you want to get like a reasonable value for Polkadot. What you do is you compare it to the top dog in space. So the top dog for smart contract project is obviously Ethereum. So you know how does Polkadot compare to Ethereum? Then you use that to extrapolate how much value you expect Polkadot to attain. You get that? So it's just that simple. So for the maximum top project in the space, Ethereum, the maximum value for Ethereum has attained, you write that. The minimum value Ethereum has attained, you write that. Because then you know that, you know what's, because what this tells you is, in the good and bad times of Ethereum, this is what you expect. So you know that in this new project you're analyzing, in this good and possible, hopefully bad time, because you want to enter when it's bad. In this good and bad time, this is what you're having. So what you expect in the good time, this is what's happening. So what you expect when the bad time comes. In the bad time, this is what's happening. And you know what to expect when the good time comes. So now, market capitalization of this project, the peak market capitalization for Ethereum, the minimum, the bottom for Ethereum. Market adaptation, Ethereum, mass adaptation, and when it was like unknown to most of the world. When was it founded? You want to know when it was founded, because you want to use the timeline of its growth to compare to what you have. And now, the project differences. The project we're analyzing now, what's the main difference from it and Ethereum? You get. So now, moving to the next one, sentiment analysis. Now, there are a lot of tools here. If you check here, see a lot of tools that you can use for your sentiment analysis. And also, but the problem here is some of these coins, some of these cryptos, they are still new in the space. Some of these cryptos will be new in the space. They won't be covered by some of these sites. Sorry. So it will be hard to perform sentiment analysis on that. That's where ATB comes in. So we'll be teaching you how to use Python and some other tools to perform sentiment analysis. And it's very easy. 30 minutes, you're done. So you'll be scraping site like Reddit and Twitter and Telegram to do your sentiment analysis to know what the public perception of any crypto you are thinking about buying is. So now, apart from that, now you can also check the followers of this crypto, check the average post, like the interactions on this post, and the growth rate on the social channels of this crypto. Then all of that, now you score them over 10. Understand? So that's another quick way of performing sentiment analysis for you. So now the sentiment, that's the distance from the local top this is the tool, sentiment. When you go on the site, you understand this better. The price and on-chain data divergence, token velocity and social trend, all of this, we're covering a lot of on-chain analytics too, because this is a cryptocurrency analytics channel. No shilling here. So now, developer activities. This one is where your crypto MISO and GitHub comes in. So you go on this channel and see their rating. Crypto MISO rates cryptocurrency projects according to their growth, their development growth. So you see where your own project rates. And also GitHub activity. You also see, what is the word for GitHub fork itself? There's a fork here, but there's also something. Repos. You can also check the repos on GitHub. And you can also check the interaction activity to know how active the project is. Then now, CoinGecko watch list. When a project has a high CoinGecko watch list, it means that